All right. Good morning, guys. Seems a little hot. I'll take it, though, because nothing's hot right now. Welcome to Identity Church. We're excited that you're here with us if you're here in person and brave the weather, the elements to come out in the cold. And if you're at home, we thank you for tuning in and watching. We don't blame you for staying there in the warm. We're excited to be kind of back into our new year. We didn't meet last Sunday because of the cold, how bitter cold it was. So we're just glad to be back in the routine of meeting together this week. And so just a reminder, we start at 11 from here on out, at least until football season next year. And if we're still here at Stag at that point. So we'll be meeting at 11 o'clock, not 10 o'clock. And we'd love to have you join us here downtown. My voice is going today, so y'all are just going to have to bear with me. A few announcements very quickly you'll see on the screen behind me. If you want to connect with us on our website, you can do that through scanning the QR code. Through scanning the QR code behind me, that'll take you to our Connect page on our website. While you're there, you can go to the main page, and there's a couple of buttons there that you can click on to support us if you'd like to as a church at identitychurchokc.com. Or you can text the amount you'd like to give to 84321 and donate through text message, or you can drop it in the box in the back. Let me say this very quickly. If you have given us a check in the last couple of weeks, we're having a deposit problem with our bank. It is resolved now, so if those checks have hung up for a little bit and you haven't seen them go through, they should be going through early this next week. I apologize for that, and we're getting that squared away, or did get it squared away on Friday, and we should be good moving forward. So if you have those questions, now you have the answer. We asked during the service, do not use this restroom right here. It's a little bit of a distraction for everybody. If you'll go up the stairs and go to the one upstairs, that would be great. We've got overtime discussion, but before we talk about that real quickly, the ladies are going to try and start their Bible study back tomorrow night, if the weather permits. Jennifer will reach out to you if just to let you know what's going on with that. I know we've got an ice storm coming in, potentially. I mean, it's Oklahoma. It's going to be an ice storm from no precipitation to 18 feet of ice and snow. So whatever happens, she will let you know what the plan is tomorrow night. I think that's all of our main announcements that we need to advise you of. One very quick one. You didn't see it up here. Hopefully tonight or today, but if you have been looking at purchasing something off of our Teespring page, that will be deactivated very soon, so just be patient. We're opening up a new online store for T-shirts and different things from the church, and just be looking for that. We'll let you know when that's open. It's going to be a little bit cheaper, a lot faster on getting your product to you. Teespring was taking 3 to 4 weeks to get stuff to people, and so just be paying attention to that here in the next couple of weeks. Overtime, it's a discussion we have after the service to dig a little bit deeper into the text. I'll give you a little bit more information on that. Most of you here are old hats on that. We've had people at home ask why we don't televise that. Televise? What the heck? Where? I just jump back to the 60s. Wow. Why we don't live stream that. And that's mainly because we want the conversation for two reasons. Mainly because we want the conversation to be authentic and genuine. And when people are being recorded, they hold back. And so that's one of the main reasons we don't let's live stream that. Oh my gosh, why we don't live stream that. The second reason is this: we want to give you a reason to be here. And if we put all of our stuff out there, you'd just be like, I don't want to be there. So we want to give you a reason to come here and be here in person, and our overtime discussion is one of those things. And so let me open with prayer. I'm going to hand it over to the praise team, and we'll get started. God, thank you so much for today. Thank you for this chance, even in the cold weather, to come and be a part of worship together. God, we pray that today will honor and glorify you in your name. Amen.
Set a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. And I've got a peaceful, easy feeling.
As it is written, therefore I will praise you among the Gentiles. I will sing the praises of your name. Again it says, rejoice you Gentiles with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles. Let all the peoples extol him. And again, Isaiah says, the root of Jesse will spring up, one who will arise to rule over the nations. In him the Gentiles will hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. All creation I see, praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Thank you, guys. Jamie, you sounded great for somebody who wasn't going to sing. That was awesome, man. I think this cold's getting to everybody. Are you sitting up there? I don't want to block you in. All right, come on, come on, come on. My voice has been shot for days because of the cold. There we go. All right. Hey, I'm really excited. I was frustrated last week that we didn't have church. I mean, I'm the one who made the call, so it's not like I was upset with anybody else. But The reason I was frustrated with it, I hate cold weather. I don't know if you know this about me. I absolutely hate cold weather. For me, that starts at anywhere about 49 degrees and down. Yeah, cold weather should be 50 and like 50 to 70 is cold. But last week, the subject we wanted to talk about, we moved to this week. And the reason I was kind of frustrated with not having church last week is because I was so excited about talking about today's subject. What we're going to talk about today is at the core of who, from the get-go, when God laid the vision of Identity Church on my heart, this is the subject at the core of why I wanted to start this church. It is at the core, it's one of two verses that gave me the name Identity for Identity Church. And so for me, we've got to get this right. For the way that I see church, we've got to get this right. This is a big deal, and I hope that in our overtime discussion afterward, we can unpack that a little bit more than what we get to during the next 20, 25 minutes of this message. But this is important, so just hear me on that. So I want to start off, though, and ask you this question. Why are you the way you are? Why are you the way you are? And furthermore, why are you who you are? So I grew up on the south side of Oklahoma City in a wonderful family. Even if they weren't wonderful, I couldn't say it here. But I grew up in a wonderful family. We were in church every Sunday. We went on vacation with church groups. We went snow skiing every year with church groups. We did things like everything of my life revolved around church. So from a very early age on, I have always used the word Christian as part of my identity. As I got a little bit older, not just was I a part of the Atchley family and a Christian, as I got a little bit older and fell in love with baseball, I would have used the idea of baseball as part of my identity. I played ball in high school, if you could call it that. I mean, it was high school, but the way I played might not have been able to be called baseball, but... I played baseball in high school and loved the game. It's to this day, it's not just that I love the Astros, it's I love baseball. I love everything about baseball. I love the smell of the park. I love the foods that you get there. I love just the classic nature, the fact that Major League Baseball celebrates 150 years this year. You know, there's so much that I love about baseball, and I've always thought that part of my identity is wrapped up in baseball. About the time I turned 15 and a half and got the keys to my first car, a 1979 Camaro, all of a sudden I started thinking I might be a car guy. I fell in love with cars, fell in love with driving cars and working on cars and building cars and customizing cars. And if you would have asked me any time from about 16 years old until, I don't know, 47 years old, I would have said, I'm 47 right now, I would say that cars are a big part of who I am and part of my identity. And if you don't like cars, then you don't like me. No. There's all these things that we use to identify ourselves. I could keep going. I could say, for the last 25 years now, I've been a husband, and how important that is to my identity. For the last 22 years, I've been a dad, and how important that is to my identity. Not only am I a dad, I'm a dad of two boys, and those boys who are both now men, 18 and 22 almost, that's different than being a father of two girls. I mean, that just changes who you are and changes your life, and it's that's different than somebody with one kid or no kids. I mean, it's just, and none of those are wrong, it's just different, and that's part of who I am as a person. And you start thinking about all those things that define you. So who are you? What are you? What plays into creating in you your mindset or your worldview? All those things are important. As Paul is writing this letter to the Corinthians, or the Colossians, I'm going to mess that up like five times today. Just realize I'm talking about Colossians, not Corinthians. If I mess that up, that's part of who I am. That's part of my identity. I get words mixed up. No, but as Paul is writing to the Colossians, he starts the book off by helping them understand something very important about their identity. Now, Paul is writing as a Jewish person. Paul grew up in a Jewish community. Paul, as a Jewish mother and a Greek father, maybe I got that backwards. But Paul grew up in a predominantly Jewish culture. He was being trained and was being brought up to be a Pharisee in that Jewish culture, which is about the most Jewish thing you could possibly do. His identity was wrapped up in who he was as a Jewish man. And so as he is becoming a follower of Christ, as he's kind of stepped away from that Pharisaical path that he was on and met Jesus on the road and became a follower of Christ, his identity has kind of morphed from just being a Jewish man to being a Christian. And as he's struggled with this identity himself and wrestled with the identity, it's really important for him to establish something really important for the Colossians. And there's two things in the first two verses of Colossians that I want us to look at that will help us understand what Paul says is vital to the identity of the church there in Colossae, and which is vital to our identity as a church here in Oklahoma City. And what's important about this is, as we call ourselves Identity Church, a church that finds our identity in who we are in Christ, it's important for us very specifically to understand these two things. So we're going to read just two verses out of Colossians today, and they're the most bland, boring verses in Colossians unless you understand what Paul is trying to do. So let me read these verses. You'll see them on the screen behind me, and I want to unpack just a couple of very important things out of this introduction. It says this: Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the holy and faithful brothers in Christ at Colossae, grace and peace to you and to you from God our Father. That's the introduction. That's what I want to talk about today. How do we find identity, things that define identity in that moment? Let me just kind of give you an idea real quick of why Paul starts off this way. This is a very normal Greek opening to a letter. In the Grecian days, if you were to write a letter to me, let's say Jamie's writing a letter to me, Jamie would start off, Jamie, incredible worship leader and follower of Jesus Christ, to Clay, a mediocre preacher, in the name of Jesus, peace be to you, and then he'd go on with what he has to say. So in English, we will write like, dear Clay, blah, 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 sincerely, yours truly, love Jamie, you know, whatever. So what they would do in Greek days was they would say who they are so that you had a reason to continue reading. He would write to who this is to, and then just a quick little, hey, peace be with you, you know, grace to you, hey, you know, whatever, and then give the meat of the letter, okay? What's really interesting about that, we'll see this at the end of this letter as we get to the end of Colossians, what that also does is it makes the letter feel very abrupt in how it ends. But at the first, or to us at least as English Western people, and so in the first of this book, we get a very traditional opening. Paul, an apostle of Christ, he's defining who he is by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, so Timothy is with him. They're the ones who are writing this letter and sending it. And then he says this: to the holy and faithful brothers in Christ. Now, I'm going to say this because it needs to be said. When Paul or anybody in the New Testament says to the faithful, to the holy brothers in Jesus, don't get offended by that. Don't get offended by that. That was just a very common cultural thing that the men would receive a letter like this first and they would tell their wives what the letter said. There's no implication in that the women don't deserve this letter. This isn't an equality statement. That's just how they wrote back then. And so when he says to the brothers, this is to the brothers and sisters in Christ. And so, but what I want us to focus on that's really important here is what he says before that. He says, to the holy and faithful brothers in Christ. What does he mean by to the holy and faithful? this word holy, at least to the Jewish people, to Paul as he's writing it, and to the Jewish listeners, because a lot of the people in that were going to receive this letter in Colossae were Jewish, from Jewish descent, Jewish background, so they would understand this. When Paul uses the word holy, there's a very specific definition to that word that the Jewish people held to. That word literally means set apart. So when Paul says to the holy and faithful brothers, he is saying to those who are set apart and faithful. There's two pieces there. The first one is this idea of being set apart. What does it mean to be set apart? Well, Jennifer and I are in July is our 25th anniversary. She has put up with my nonsense for 25 plus years, and we're going to go celebrate her faithfulness in that. So we have set apart a week out of our life this year to go up to Bar Harbor, Maine, and celebrate our 25 years. Bar Harbor in Boston, and we're going to go watch a baseball game because I'm into baseball and she's not. But we have set that week apart to be with her. What does it mean to be set apart? Well, for us in that week, it means that week we are only focusing on each other. The kids aren't going to be there. They're mad about that. The dog's not going to be there. We're not going to do work. We're going to turn our cell phones off probably. And we're going to set that week apart to spend time and to focus on each other. For the Jewish person, to be set apart goes all the way back to the book of Exodus. When the Jewish people were brought out of slavery in Egypt and God rescued them from that slavery and heard their cry and heard that the turmoil that they were experiencing at the hands of the Egyptians, and God led them out, as he said, on the wings of eagles. And he sets them apart as his people. He brings them across the Red Sea. He brings them into the Holy Land. They wander for 40 years because they didn't believe him at first. But he has set them apart. And right before the law is given, right before the Ten Commandments are given, right before this establishment of who they are as a people group, he says, you are a people who are set apart. You're different. There's something about you that is meant to be different. And so when Paul says to the people here in Colossians in this beautiful letter, he starts off and he says this to them: you are holy. You are set apart. You are somebody different. You are not to be like the rest of the world. Everything going on in your city and all the people that are worshiping these other gods and bringing these other things into the faith, that's not for you. There should be something different. As a matter of fact, when Peter writes his letter in 1 Peter in chapter 2, he uses the word peculiar. You're a peculiar people. He talks about us being a priesthood and being set apart, but he says to be a peculiar, a different people. And that's the point of Paul's opening, is that if you're a follower of Christ, there's something different. You're set apart. You're as Jesus prayed, that you're not taken out of the world, but you're in the world, but you're different in the world. So what does that mean? What does that mean for your identity to be set apart? It means that when you go somewhere, when you're involved in a group, you're different than everybody else. And that doesn't mean that you wear weird clothes, or you may talk different or whatever, but when you are around people that know you and know your lifestyle and engage in life with you, they look at you and say, something is different. There's a couple of reasons why God set the Israelite people apart and made them different and made them holy. One of the main reasons is so that they could bring the Messiah into the world that opens up God's will for everybody and the pathway to God through the Messiah. But the second thing is so that the other nations around them, the other nations that are struggling because they're following a human being instead of God, because they have a king instead of a heavenly king, because they have different sets of rules and they live differently, so that they would look at the Israelites and go, what is different about them? And you see, that idea carries over to us today. We're not set apart to ruin your fun. God hasn't set you apart and made you holy as a follower of his so that your life is boring. He hasn't set you apart so that he takes away from your experiences of life. As a matter of fact, Jesus said, I have come to give life and give it to the fullest. Jesus has set us apart so that when people see us, they go, What's different? Why are they different? Why are they happy in times of sorrow? Why are they able to have peace when the world's crumbling around them? Why are they able to engage with somebody that's so different than them when the world seems to divide over every possible way? Why is it that a Christian can reach across the political aisle or reach across the gender aisle or the race aisle or the economic aisle and be engaged with somebody in a very real way? Because we are set apart and we're different. And as a church, as Identity Church, this is something to the core of why we are doing what we're doing. So that if somebody is in this room that's a conservative, they can hold hands and connect and love on somebody who's a liberal. So if somebody in this room is white, black, Mexican, Hispanic, whatever, they can connect with somebody of another race, and we are equals because we're different together like that. And Paul is telling the church of Colossae, that's who you are. There's something different. The world should see you and go, I want what they have. But here's what's interesting. He says, the holy, the set apart, and the faithful. You see, when we're faithful to that calling to be different, that takes it to a whole nother step. We can say we're set apart. We can say we're a follower of Christ. We can say we're holy because God's holiness is put upon us when we trust in Him. But when we are faithful to that and we live a life according to that, that becomes very real. And I'm going to say something very just very clear and very stingy to us as a church. The world sees through the church's BS when we're not authentic. And I mean that exactly how I say it. The world sees through it when we're not authentic. When we say we're a follower, when we say we're different, and we say we're set apart, and then we don't live differently. The world sees through that, and they, hear me on this. They put that on God, not you. When you're not authentic and faithful and being set apart, yeah, some of that may mess up your reputation as a Christian, but really the truth is, they put that on God, and they say, their God's not real. If they really believed that this God is real, they wouldn't act that way. So that's why it's important to be holy and set apart and faithful. Does that make sense? Let's keep reading. It says, to the holy and faithful brothers in Christ at Colossae, grace and peace be to you from our Father in heaven. Here's what's really interesting. Not only are we set apart, but we are in God. So we're set apart as a people, but we're set in God. When he says, grace and peace be with you in God our Father, this is a really important point. Because if we're going to be different, if we're going to be set apart, we need to be grounded in something, in someone. And he says, look, you're different for a reason because you are in God. You are in Christ. And that is a better place to be. And so, church, as we begin to dig into this, it is my hope and my dream that we begin to find that all those other things that we have identified ourselves by are still important. Just because I identify as a Christian and I'm set apart as a follower of Christ, that doesn't mean that I can't like baseball anymore. But it means that my faith and my identity in Jesus is more defining to me than my love for baseball. It means that who I am and set apart in Christ is more important to me than the fact that I love cool cars. That who I am and who Christ says I am and my identity in Him and my value in Him is more important than even my identity and value in my wife. That as uplifting as she is and as valuable as she is to me and as important as it is for her to tell me she loves me, it's more important for me to find my identity in Christ than in her. And as believers, as we begin to understand that and we begin to realize that what we need in our identity isn't more other things, we just need more Christ in our identity, then the closer we'll be to who God created us to be. And that's how Paul starts his letter to the Colossian church. And so as we dig into this text, as we dig into this letter over the next few months, May we understand that our identity is in Jesus and we are set apart to be His, just as Paul says to the Colossian church. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for giving us identity in you, for helping us know who we are through who you say we are, not who we believe ourselves to be. God, I just pray that as we have over the years found all kinds of other things to say, this is who I am and that's who I am and this defines me and that defines me, let us be defined by being holy, being set apart in you, and being part of who you are and who you want us to be in this world. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. The band's going to sing a couple more songs for us, and we'll see how Jamie's voice holds up, but he's been doing great. But as they sing, I want you just to kind of ponder this idea. I want you to kind of think about what it means to have our identity in Christ. And during that, one beautiful thing that we get to do that anchors our identity in Christ is communion. On the back wall back there, we have some juice and some bread that symbolizes the blood and the body that Jesus gave for us so that we can be a part of who He is. And so if you would like to take that, we offer it every week. Don't feel obligated to take that every week, but if you'd like it every week, it is back there for you to take. Just realize that that's a very sacred thing, very important thing that we want you to engage in. Also on the prayer board, we've already got two prayers up on the prayer board. We need more. I know there's so much going on. We prayed for Kiesi earlier. We prayed for Jamie's dad earlier. We prayed for a lot of people earlier. And one of those prayers, literally within minutes of us praying, was answered, which was awesome. And so we would like for you to have more prayer requests on that board that we can pray for and lift up. And so if you need something prayed for, go back there and put it on a card and put it on that board back on the whiskey barrel in the back corner. Also, I'll be back over here behind the soundboard on the stairs. If anybody needs to just talk and have prayer, I'll be there for that. Do one of those things, if not all those things, as we sing.
Surrender. Here is where I lay it down.
Thank you for being such an amazing God. There's no one or nothing that is even remotely as good as you are, God. We thank you for that. God, we thank you for today and the opportunity we had to come here. As we leave here, keep us warm, keep us safe. And God, let us go and take your name into this city. In Christ's name, amen. Okay, we're going to take a few-minute break, and then we're going to jump into our overtime discussion. Most of you know exactly what we're doing with that, so let's go for about 5-minute break, and then we'll jump right into it. We'll see you in a second.